Hi, I'm Mike from 1A Auto. We've been selling auto parts for over 30 years. We're dedicated to delivering quality auto parts, expert customer service, fast and free shipping, all backed by our 100% satisfaction guarantee. So visit us at 1AAuto.com, your trusted source for quality auto parts.
In this video, we're going to be working with our 1996 GMC Sierra K1500. We're going to show you how to remove the intake manifold on a 5.7 liter V8. This is the entire manifold from the lower up as one piece. If you like this video, please click subscribe. We have a ton more information on this and many other vehicles. And if you ever need parts for your car, you can follow the link down in the description over to 1AAuto.com. Here are the items you'll need for this repair.
Remove the negative post from your battery using a 5/16 or an 8mm wrench. Be very careful, this wrench isn't long enough, but if you have a longer one, you may be able to hit the positive battery terminal with it. You want to be very careful you don't do that. Remove the terminal and isolate it from the battery.
Now, to give us a little more access to the other side, we'll undo the thumb screw on top of the throttle body. Pop that off, disconnect the breather hose, undo the mass airflow and intake air temp sensors. And where we're going to be disconnecting so many wires here, I went ahead and labeled all of them with painter's tape. You can choose to do that or take pictures. There's a variety of ways to do it. Undo the latches on the airbox, lift it up. Remove your air filter and take the entire intake setup off the truck. You'll need to disconnect the positive side of the battery. We removed it entirely, so we had some more room to show you guys what was going on. Pull the harness coming from the battery and over to the ECU, out of the top of the fan shroud. Just move it off to the side for now. We'll then remove the three 10mm bolts along the top of the fan shroud. We'll then use a 10mm socket, ratchet, and a long extension to get, it looks like there were two 10mm bolts on each side. However, we've only got one, so we'll remove one from each side of our fan shroud. You can then remove the upper radiator shroud from the vehicle. Use a 3/8 drive breaker bar or ratchet to release the tension from the tensioner and remove your serpentine belt. Remove your radiator cap by pushing down and turning it counterclockwise. If you look down below your upper radiator hose, you'll see the drain plug for the radiator. We're going to reach down there, and we have our drip pan underneath the truck. So we're going to reach down and unscrew that. Using a pair of pliers or groove jaws like we have here, collapse the clamps on the upper radiator hose and remove the hose from the radiator. We'll then do the same thing on the thermostat housing side of the hose. We can now remove the upper radiator hose from the vehicle. Remove the throttle cables by flipping the lever out. Pop the plastic one out of its clip, and then pull the cable for the main throttle cable around until it sits into the notch, and you slide the cable end out. Use a pair of pliers to collapse the tabs on the throttle cable retainers and pull them through their bracket. Push down on the tabs on the bottom side of the throttle cable bracket. Pop the retainer out for the cruise control cable. Then use your flat blade screwdriver to pop the clamp open for the main throttle cable and lay both of these out of the way.
Remove the connector on the back of the AC compressor. Use a flat blade screwdriver to pop the retainer open and lay it over the compressor. We'll also disconnect the switch on the back. We'll use a small flat blade to pry off the ears on the AC compressor clutch connector. Just let all that hang out of the way for now. Pop out the AC compressor line on the passenger side of the engine, pushing the tabs down and pulling it out of the retainer. Then remove the four 13 millimeter bolts on the top of the AC compressor. We'll then lift the AC compressor off its bracket and carefully place it in the passenger side of the engine bay. Remove the 10 millimeter bolt on the back of the alternator. We'll then remove the two 13 millimeters on the front. Pry the alternator up and out of its housing. Then remove the connector. Pull back the boot and remove the 13 millimeter nut on the power stud. Remove the alternator from the vehicle. Remove the 10 millimeter bolt right above the idler pulley. This secures the outlet hose on the water pump to this accessory bracket, which we're going to remove. And just so we don't lose this bolt, we'll move the hose out of the way. You can release it from the retainer if you have to. And just throw that 10 millimeter back in there, a couple of threads so we don't lose it. Use the 13 millimeter socket and ratchet to remove the center bolt from the tensioner. And remove the tensioner from the vehicle. Pry open the retainer for the alternator power wire. Pull that out of the way. Then use our screwdriver to release this radiator hose as well. This is the one for the heater core that goes to the top of the intake manifold. Remove the two 15 millimeter bolts as well as the 15 millimeter nut securing the alternator bracket to the front of the engine. We'll do this with a 15 millimeter socket, ratchet, and extension. Remove the accessory bracket from the vehicle. Pinch together the two plastic tabs on the heater hose, wiggle them out of their holder, lay that hose off to the side. Remove the clamp on the water pump to heater hose. Remove the hard pipe. Lay that off to the side as well. Remove the 15 millimeter nut securing the grounds to the top of the thermostat housing. Remove the grounds. Put that nut back on finger tight just so we don't lose it later. We'll then lift up on the tab, disconnect the coolant temp sensor and the EGR. Pry out the retainer for the harness. We'll then disconnect the throttle position sensor, as well as the idle air control valve connector. Let that whole harness hang out of the way. Underneath the vehicle, you'll find the crank position sensor behind the harmonic balancer. Disconnect that. Move the harness up and out of the way. Use a 14 millimeter wrench to loosen this nut behind the bottom water pump hose for the lower radiator. There's a ground strap on here that we'll need to remove in order to get this harness up and out of our way. Slide the ground off of the stud, and then we'll just throw that nut on there, a couple of threads to hold it in place. Then have a retainer right here that we'll need to pop open with our flat blade screwdriver. another retainer here. Disconnect the vacuum solenoid connection here, as well as the one behind it. It's a little tricky to see under the harness, but you'll also need to remove your MAP sensor connector and release this section of the harness. Lift up on the white safety tab and use a small flat blade screwdriver to pry out the ears. Carefully lift up on the connector and remove it from the top of the manifold. Open up the harness retainer on the passenger side valve cover. And if we have enough stuff disconnected here, we also have one over here on the driver's side. You'll also have to disconnect the connector over on the driver's cylinder head here. We should have enough slack to lay our harness to the back of the engine. We're not ready to do that just yet. Remove the spark plug wires from the spark plugs. Don't worry about where these go right now because the distributor is marked with the positions of all the plug wires. And we'll show you the firing order when we put it back together. Be sure to open up all the wire looms and release the plug wires from them. We'll repeat these steps on the opposite side. Disconnect the plug wire from the ignition coil as well. Remove the two T20 Torx screws, one here and one on the back side of the distributor. We'll do this using a T20 Torx bit, a ratchet, and an extension. Now these are not captured, so what I like to do is loosen them up pretty much all the way and then lift up on the distributor cap and bring that out nice and smooth and level. So we're careful not to lose those screws. Before removing your distributor, be sure that the engine is at top dead center compression. This means that the vehicle's distributor will be in the correct timing placement, so when we align the timing marks and reinstall it later, it'll go in hassle-free. This is a very important part of the engine's timing, which will allow us to set our distributor in the correct place. It's a good time to show you what TDC is and why we use it. On the driver's side of the timing cover, there's this little ear with a notch in it. We use a 16 millimeter socket and ratchet on the center bolt of the crank pulley to rotate it. And this is a bit more difficult with the engine assembled because you'll have compression you need to deal with. But rotate it clockwise only, nice and smooth and slow, and you'll see a notch on the crank pulley. This notch right there tells us that our piston is at top dead center. This means that the number one piston is at its highest point in the cylinder bore, and you can see that this is actually almost flush with the deck of the block at this point. And the other important part is that we're going to want that on top dead center compression. Now, if the engine was together, right in those last few degrees before I got that line marked up with the crank, it would get really tight because of the compression in the motor. If you don't feel that compression when rotating it, it means that cylinder number one is in its intake stroke, which is not what we're after for timing.
However, where there's no compression due to the head being off right now, another easy way to check is both our lifters are down. You can see what one looks like when it's up here. These are what open the valves. These are part of what open the valves in the vehicle. So if they're both down, both our valves are closed, our piston would be at the top of the bore, and our engine would be in its compression stroke on cylinder number one. Using a 13 millimeter wrench, loosen the bolt on the distributor hold down plate, which is below the distributor on the passenger side of the motor. Now they do make special distributor wrenches for this, which are nice to have, but you can get by with a regular wrench. It's just a little more time consuming. Remove the hold down bracket from the distributor. Disconnect the electrical connector on the back of your distributor and carefully wiggle the assembly up and out of the back of the engine. Remove the cap on the Schrader valve on your fuel rail. We'll then put some paper towels around it and use a flat blade screwdriver to press the top pin. Be sure to wear safety glasses and stay out of the way of this because they tend to bleed off a little bit of pressure. Using a pair of pliers, compress the clip on the vacuum hose for the brake booster and remove it from the bracket. It helps to twist these to free them up. Pull it out, lay it off to the side. Using a 16 millimeter flare nut wrench, loosen the fuel fittings on the back of the fuel lines. These are down behind the intake on the driver's side. Remove the two 10 millimeter nuts, securing the ignition coil and control module bracket to the top of the engine. We'll do this using a 10 millimeter socket, ratchet, and extension. Lift up on the bracket. Move it around the module and the coil. Be careful of any other sensors in the area. You can now lay the whole engine harness up into the back of the engine. Just going to make this whole process a lot easier for us. We'll now remove the two 10 millimeter nuts on the studs just below the two we just removed. You can then remove the ignition coil and module as well as the bracket from the engine. Using a 22 millimeter wrench, loosen the EGR tube nut going into the intake at the driver's side front of the lower intake manifold. Pop the connector out of its retainer. Lay that off to the side. Disconnect the breather hose on the intake coming from the driver's side valve cover and lay that off to the side. Using a 13 millimeter socket, ratchet, and extension, remove the hold down on the EGR tube at the back driver's side of the intake manifold. Remove the 14 millimeter nut and two 14 millimeter bolts in the power steering pump bracket. We'll do this with a 14 millimeter socket and ratchet. To remove the power steering pump pulley, you'll need a power steering pump pulley puller tool, which we have here. It's actually a few separate pieces. We'll show you how they go together and how to remove the pulley with them. The fan on this truck is staggered, so the blades are not equidistant from each other. The largest gap is here, so we'll rotate that in front of our power steering pump pulley so it doesn't interfere. Install the shaft of the puller into the hole in the center of the power steering pump pulley. Get that down as far as you can, and then loosen the nut here. Make sure that it's still on the threads, even when it's bottomed out. We'll then take these two half moon style clamps and place the wider end around the pulley with the skinnier end around our puller. And this sleeve will go over them and hold them together. You can now turn the center and hold the nut or vice versa until that locks into place. So we'll use a 21 millimeter wrench to hold the nut and a 17 millimeter to drive the shaft in, which will pull the nut with our clamp and sleeve on it out, bringing the pulley off of the shaft. Ours is really pressed on there tight, so we're using a ratchet and a socket just to get a little more leverage on it. It'll eventually pop off, and we can remove all of this from our vehicle. Using a 13 millimeter socket and ratchet, remove the remaining bolts from the power steering pump bracket. Ours was covered in some grease, so we didn't see it at first, but at the bottom inside corner of the power steering pump bracket, there's a 14 millimeter bolt that will need to be removed. Remove the bolt, release this hose clamp at the top, the flat blade screwdriver. Remove the power steering pump bracket. Remove the 8 bolts around the perimeter of the lower intake manifold. There are 2 in each corner. With a 13 millimeter socket and ratchet, and an extension is necessary. Using a pair of pliers, collapse the clamp on the thermostat hose going into the water pump. You can do this on either end, it's just that our other one looks pretty rusty, so we're gonna leave that alone for now. Slide the clamp off, wiggle the hose to free it up, and then pop it off. Remove the 4 10 millimeter bolts on each valve cover with a 10 millimeter socket, ratchet, and extension. Remove the valve cover. Be sure to mark which is left and which is right, as they are different. Repeat these steps on the opposite side. Remove this valve cover as well. Don't forget to remove the vacuum hose before removing your intake manifold. Once the valve covers are off, you can lift up and remove your intake manifold. Lay your intake manifold over. We've actually just removed ours from the parts washer, which is why it's a little wet right now. What we're going to do is remove the old gasket material, as well as the gasket sealer along the valley portion of the intake manifold. And then we're going to scrape it all down clean with a razor blade. Now we'll wipe down the gasket surfaces with some solvent. Make sure all the dirt and oil and residue is removed from it. Use a razor blade to scrape any residue off the flat portions in the engine valley here at both the front and the rear. And these here shouldn't be there, so we'll just pick those out real quick. Once everything is removed, spray some solvent on a clean paper towel and wipe down both surfaces. Make sure they are free and clear of oil and debris, as we're going to need to use
some gasket maker here. Just have a little piece of tape left over from painting our heads that we're going to want to remove. We'll now install our intake manifold gaskets. Make sure they line up. And there are two locking pins underneath that will snap into the head. Keep that gasket in place. Put some gasket maker into the valley corners here. You want to get the corner under the intake gasket and then run it right along. You don't want to go too thick. Just like that should be fine. We'll do the same thing in the rear. And this stuff is time sensitive, so make sure your intake manifold is ready to go on. Then set your intake manifold back into place. Ensure that your gaskets are aligned and reinstall the 8 bolts, 2 in each corner of the lower intake manifold. Remember to leave the bolt out for the EGR tube hold down on the back driver's side, and then tighten down the 7 13 millimeter bolts with a socket ratchet and extension. Kind of like our head gasket, we'll want to go from front to back, cross over a little bit when we tighten down our hardware here to make sure that it doesn't pinch in one corner so that all 4 sides seal evenly. Tighten the bolts in 3 steps using the sequence shown. The first sequence is to 71 inch-pounds, the second at 106 inch-pounds, and the final sequence will torque these bolts to 11 foot-pounds. Install your new valve cover gasket. It does have to be stretched in there a little bit. Reinstall your valve cover. Start your 4 10 millimeter bolts. We'll do the same thing on the opposite side. Reinstall the other valve cover the same way. We'll reinstall those 4 10 millimeter screws as well by hand, and then we'll tighten all 8, 4 on each side with our 10 millimeter socket and ratchet, which will then tighten and torque to 106 inch-pounds. Realign your EGR tube. You'll need a 22 millimeter wrench to get it started. Line up the bracket for the EGR tube once the valve cover is on and the front is in place. Reinstall the 13 millimeter hold down bolt with a 13 millimeter socket ratchet and extension. Reattach the fuel lines at the rear of the intake manifold. Using a 16 millimeter flare wrench, tighten down the fittings on the fuel lines. Using a T20 Torx socket, ratchet, and extension, remove the 2 T20 Torx screws from your new distributor cap if it came as one piece. Now, these are not captured, so you want to be very careful not to lose them. Once those screws are loose, remove your cap. Then using
a T10 Torx either screwdriver or bit. Remove the two Torx screws in the center of the rotor. Once again, these are not captured, so be very careful not to lose these. And remove your rotor from the distributor.
Once we've removed the cap and rotor from our new distributor, the correct way to align one of these will line up the 8 in this window with the notch in the housing. This will also leave the side of this window lined up with the edge of the cam sensor riser there. We'll then set it so that this is just about flush to the back of the engine. You can move it a little way one way or the other. Drop it in, line up our tab, and start our bolt. A few threads by hand to keep it in place until we start our engine and fine-tune it. Set the distributor in with the flat portion of the housing facing the front of the engine. And if your timing marks are correct, it should drop right into place. Start the 13mm bolt into the hold down on your distributor. Now we're going to put this down snug, but not fully tight just yet, because we want to make sure the truck runs and runs right. We'll now install the rotor onto the distributor and tighten down the two T10 Torx screws. Now when you're in time, that tab should be facing roughly towards cylinder one, which is going to be the driver's front, and it is now. Now what we're doing here is just a rough timing or base timing. So this should be enough to get the vehicle running. However, with these distributors, you do need a scan tool in order to get them dialed in perfectly. Plug in the cam position sensor on the back of the distributor now, as it's going to be a lot harder to get out once we put the cap on. Reinstall the distributor cap. Then tighten down your two T20 Torx screws with a T20 Torx bit, ratchet, an extension, or a Torx screwdriver, whichever you prefer. Just don't put these down too tight because they're only going into plastic, and these are notorious for breaking. So if you did what we did and threaded the bolts back into the intake just so you wouldn't lose them, you're gonna want these two studs. These are in the actual aluminum of the lower intake. This is where we'll reinstall our ignition coil and ignition control module. These are 10mm, but for right now, we're just gonna get them in there and get them started by hand. We'll then tighten down the two bolts with a 10mm socket, ratchet, and extension. Lay the hold down bracket for the wiring harness back into place. So reinstall the two 10mm nuts onto the hold down for the wire harness bracket here. We'll then tighten them down with a 10mm socket, ratchet, and extension. Reinstall your power steering and AC bracket. Reinstall all of your 13mm hardware, which you should have marked on a bolt path, sort of like this. And don't forget, you also have the nut that goes on that stud on the front of the bracket. Tighten down the power steering pump bolts with the 13mm socket and ratchet. We'll then tighten down the four power steering pump bracket bolts, three bolts and a nut, with a 14mm socket and ratchet. So we purchased a power steering pulley puller and installer tool set, but the problem is the threads on our installer tool either don't work or the threads inside of our power steering pump shaft are damaged. So we whipped up a tool with some things we found already in the engine of our truck, and we'll show you what we made. Now our alternator bracket is off since we're doing our cylinder heads. However, if yours is still attached, this process will still work. You'll simply use a 14mm socket and ratchet to remove this nut, which would secure the bracket on.
and then you'll use either a pair of vice grips or preferably an E8 inverted Torx socket and ratchet to remove the stud from the front of the head. Once again, since we have our head apart, some of these pieces are already off, but we also used the nut that holds down the ground on our thermostat housing cover. We'll place the thermostat housing cover nut onto the back of the stud that we removed from our head. We'll then take the nut that we removed from this stud and install it backwards as far down as we can. Then we're going to use this spacer that I had lying around the shop. You could also use a large washer. You want to make sure it's a nice thick one. We'll toss that on there as a trolley, so when we tighten down this nut, it won't rotate this. It'll just push it in and push our pulley on. We're just going to apply a thin coat of brake grease onto the shaft here to try to make our pulley go on just a little bit easier. Line up the pulley onto the shaft. Installed the stud. You want to get that in as tight as you can to start. Then run in our 14 millimeter nut into the spacer, which is going to help center our pulley. We'll then use one 14 millimeter wrench to hold the stud and the pump shaft in place, and another 14 millimeter wrench to tighten down the nut on the installer. Reinstall the stud into the Bank 2 cylinder head with your E8 inverted Torx socket and ratchet. Make sure it bottoms out. Press the clamp for the water pump hose and reinstall it onto its fitting. Then reinstall your alternator bracket. We'll then tighten down all of the 14 millimeter hardware with a socket and ratchet. Reinstall your alternator into the bracket. Reinstall the two 13 millimeter bolts at the bottom of the alternator. Reinstall the 10 millimeter bolt in the back of the alternator. Tighten it down with your 10 millimeter socket and ratchet. Reconnect all of your electrical connectors and vacuum hoses. Apply some thread sealant to the coolant temp sensor and reinstall it into the Bank 1 cylinder head if you removed it earlier like we did to paint. Reconnect that electrical connector as well. Reinstall the ground strap at the bottom front of the motor. Tighten down the 14 millimeter nut. Reconnect the crank position sensor. Snap the heater hose back into place. Clip it back into its plastic retainer as well. We'll also run the other heater line back through its bracket. Forget to remove your bolt if you kept it there like we did. Reconnect the heater hose and use a pair of pliers to move the clamp back into position. Reinstall your 10 millimeter bolt. Reconnect the alternator power terminal to the stud on the back of the alternator. We'll re-secure this with the 13 millimeter washer and nut. Reinstall your throttle cables. Remember to hook them into the bracket over the AC compressor. Loop them around. The one with the barrel end like this goes into the square slot. Then open the throttle body blade. Install it by looping it around into its slot and flipping it back into place. Then send the round cruise control cable in, lock that in, and just snap that hook back over its tab. Install the vacuum booster line on the rear of the intake manifold. I'm going to use locking jaw pliers this time to compress the clamp. That can be a little bit easier sometimes, depending on what style. Put the AC compressor back into its bracket and reinstall the four bolts, and then tighten them down with a 13 millimeter socket, ratchet, and extension. Reconnect the connector on the AC compressor clutch and the two connectors on the back. Reinstall the tensioner and the 13 millimeter bolt in the center. Don't forget to line up that tab on the back with its hole in the bracket. And tighten down the 13 millimeter bolt with a socket and ratchet. Reinstall the serpentine belt around the crankshaft. The right side, the driver's side of the belt will go up and over the water pump, down and under the power steering pulley, up and over the AC compressor, under the idler pulley at the top, and the passenger side will come up over the tensioner. Hold the tensioner with the drive of a 3/8 ratchet and rotate it counterclockwise to release the tension. So you can slide it over the alternator pulley. Ensure that the belt is routed correctly. Release the tension and remove your ratchet. Using a pair of locking jaw pliers, compress the clamp on the upper radiator hose. If you removed yours fully from the radiator, we're going to install the radiator side first. Release the clamp. Compress the clamp for the thermostat side. We left ours on the housing. Reinstall that hose, as well as its clamp. Reinstall the upper fan shroud. If you remember, ours was missing two bolts, so we'll only be reinstalling five. Yours should have seven. Don't forget to route the power wire back over from your battery. Place the coil plug back onto the ignition coil, and then the passenger rear on the distributor is marked C for your coil, so we'll reinstall that line there. And the rest of them are pretty self-explanatory. It goes 6, 4, 2, 8 on the passenger side. We'll reinstall those wires in the same order and then connect them to the corresponding spark plug. Remember, the passenger bank at the front is cylinder 2, followed by 4, 6, 8. While the driver's side starts with cylinder 1 and goes 3, 5, 7. Once all the wires are plugged in, we'll route them along to their appropriate plugs. Now your distributor cap is marked on the opposite side, so repeat this process and install the wires over there as well.
Reinstall the upper intake and the thumb screw. Reconnect your PCV breather hose. Reinstall the mass airflow and intake air temp sensors.
Install the airbox lid and snap it down into place. Reconnect your negative battery terminal and tighten it back down with an 8mm socket and ratchet or an 8mm wrench.
Once you've refilled the coolant and changed your oil, you're ready to start your vehicle.
Thanks for watching. Visit us at 1AAuto.com for quality auto parts, fast and free shipping, and the best customer service in the industry.